This is the Literary License Podcast with your hosts, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shorgo, discussing book to screen and everything in between, coming at you from the UK and USA.
They keep it real.
You each have a lethal weapon. If you denounce me to the police, you will also be exposed and humiliated. I'll see to that in court. But if one of you kills Wadsworth now, no one but the seven of us will ever know. He has the key to the front door, which he said would only be opened over his dead body. I suggest we take him up on that offer. The only way to avoid finding yourselves on the front pages is for one of you to kill Wadsworth. Now.
Let the games begin.
He was a most cruel man. Monsieur Twain would come to France every season to hunt poodles.
I don't understand. Why would anybody want to steal a dead, naked body?
Yes, I did it. I killed Yvette. I hated her so much. It flames on the side of my face, breathing.
I like her. I really like her.
Ladies and gentlemen, but I'll tell you this. For the first time in my life, I had the caca scared out of me.
Hello, welcome to the Literary License Podcast. And today we're going to be discussing Murder by Death, the 1976 comedy classic written by Neil Simon, and the 1985 comedy classic Clue, based on the Parker Brothers board game. And of course, we have with us today Vicky Ray, our normal host. Say hello, Vicky.
Hi, guys. Hi.
And John Wilson.
What up, folks? Hi.
And before we get started, due to the nature of our series today, or our episode, I should say, we're going to be discussing our most favorite mystery, whether it's a nonfiction or fiction. So, Vicky, starting out with you, what's your favorite mystery?
I would say mystery series or books would probably be Jessica Fletcher in Murder She Wrote. I kind of liked it back in the day because they had a middle-aged woman and she was, just kicking butt with all these murders and whatnot. And that series, it aired for like 12 seasons from 84 to 96 on CBS and did really good. It got Golden Globes and everything. It was just kind of nice to see. Angela Lansbury played the part and I enjoyed it because I really did like watching an older woman do all that Sherlock Holmes stuff.
Well, between you and me, I think that she was a serial killer and she's go town to town and kill everyone and then blame it on other people. And that's why I think Murder She Wrote.
I didn't get that out.
I agree. I agree with Keith. Like, she was really good at like spinning it. It's your fault. What?
I mean, could you imagine? It's like you get a phone call. It's like, you know, hi, it's Jessica Fletcher. I'm coming to spend the weekend. It's like, oh shit, who's going to die this weekend?
Or it would have been amazing because, every end of a movie or something was a big reveal, like who the killer really was, you know, that would have been an amazing way to end the series. Like, ha ha ha, I fooled them all.
What TV actor actor or actress who hasn't worked in a long time is going to who's going to die and who's going to be the killer?
Yeah.
It's like the Love Boat of murder.
Well, yeah, exactly.
Ask me and I told you, and then you put a big spin on my thing.
No, I like Murder. I mean, Murder, She Wrote is like, it's like a comfy pair of slippers and your raggedy old jeans is very comforting. It's still you still see it come on every once in a while, and you put it on, and you got your cup of tea, and I still watch it.
It's actually on Netflix too. So if you like, I was actually binging a bunch of episodes the other day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it had 12 seasons. That was pretty successful.
I mean, the biggest mystery I found of Angela Lansbury, that ever since she was 20 years old, she looked 70. So that's quite amazing. She looked 70 for her whole career.
She was in a movie with Vic Morrow. I can't remember what the name of it was. And they had her dressed up sort of like Grecian goddess-like. But she was kind of cute back in the day. But she was still Angela Lansbury.
Well, she played Elvis Presley's mother in Blue Hawaii. And Elvis Presley was 3 years older than she was.
No, that's true. That's true. Now I'm going to watch that and look at it.
Look at Bedknobs and Broomsticks. She looked old in that, and she was only like.
Well, they made her look older in that.
I love that movie.
Which one?
Bedknobs and Broomsticks. Yeah. I love that movie.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. We used to watch it when we were kids. I love the old stuff.
And she'll always be Mrs. Potts.
Yes.
Now off to the cupboard with you, now Chip. What about you?
He was killed in the cupboard by a cop.
And what about yourself, John? What's your favorite mystery, nonfiction or fiction?
I love movies that make me think about what's real and what's not. Makes me question about reality and situations. Like, I love the movie Uninvited. It's in 2009, directed by Charles Thomas Gard. It's really, really good and weird and mind-bending. But I also love, like, Clue was actually one of my favorite movies.
Absolutely.
It's just because it puts a spin on it with the comedic. I wish they actually made more movies like this and Death by Murder. But another one, an honorable mention, is Gosford Park, which has Maggie Smith, who is in Murder by Death. That's actually really funny and witty and brilliant. I just wish they actually made more mysteries like that and made it just put a comedic spin on it.
And my favorite mystery is more of a nonfiction. I'm always still amazed with the Bermuda Triangle. I don't know what it is, but every time someone thinks about it, I still watch it. It's one of those mysteries is like, why? I mean, but in saying that, I mean, nothing's disappeared recently.
Right.
Maybe people's personality got sucked out there in the Bermuda Triangle while they're on their geriatric cruising. But, But I always found that a bit amazing that, you know, you had this, you know, patch of ocean and, you know, things just used to disappear and they never would find it. And I've always been quite interested with the Amelia Earhart, what happened to her, or the Charles.
Oh, yeah. Movie. Yeah.
So I always found like those kind of mysteries kind of bizarre. And anytime I see documentaries, I always kind of watch them. And my mind tends to ponder about that.
Try to dissect it, right?
Remember Leonard Nimoy when he used to host In Search Of? I religiously watched that.
I remember that. Yeah.
Remember all that sort of stuff. They were really good. As far as books are concerned, I have to sit there and say I've just started reading, I just finished reading and did a review on it, of this new author that's out at the moment. And he's done these murder mysteries set in 1600 London during the fire. And it was called Ashes of London. And I just got his second book to review now.
Oh, cool.
His name is Andrew Taylor, and he's, you know, a number one best-selling author at the moment. But I'm finding that very interesting. If I do weird mysteries, I like it if they're, like, set back in time, because that's where I'm getting a lot of hysterical information, but I still get the whole murder mystery. So, but
that sounds cool.
Yeah, it's very good. I highly recommend it. So, but I guess that leads us now to forming the plot. Now, basically, the first movie we're going to cover today is Murder by Death. It is a film directed by Robert Moore. Now, Robert Moore was more of a Broadway director. He did the original cast of Promises, Promises, They're Playing Our Song, and a bunch of other Broadways. But he's also known as the director to bring gay rights to the fore in a play called Boys from the Band. Him and Neil Simon were very, very close. And Neil Simon, due to his play, Come Blow Your Horn, was made into a movie. He wasn't very happy. So what would happen is Neil Simon became very, very attached to his film projects and made sure he was on board and he would write screenplays. Through this, with his friendship with Robert Moore, he and his brother, Neil Simon's brother, basically, while they were in World War II, when they weren't fighting, they would go to the movies. And some of the movies that they would watch would be these murder mystery movies, which would include Charlie Chan, the Thin Man series, which is Nick and Nora Charles, Poirot, and Sam Spade, which of course is Maltese Falcon character. And he was sitting around with Robert Moore, and basically they had a discussion about what would happen if he put all these detectives in one room and had them solve a murder mystery. And hence is how Murder by Death was born. Now, it's basically a satirical murder mystery film, and it has fantastic comedy cast with Eileen Brennan, Truman Capote, which is his last film, James Coco, Peter Falk, Alec Guinness, Elsa Lanchester's last film, David Niven, one of his last films, Peter Sellers, pretty much his one of his last films, Maggie Smith, Nancy Walker, and Estelle Winwood. And basically, it's a comedy about them solving the perfect murder. So to get us started, what we're going to do before we get started, we're going to have a commercial break and a trailer, and then we'll be back to discuss Murder by Death.
Let's play a game. I will ask you yes or no questions. Ready? Do you have a rocking chair to relax on? Do you have space to store your toddler's toys if an unexpected guest came over? Can you lay down comfortably on your couch? If your answer is no to one or more of these questions, then you need the new IKEA catalog. Visit IKEA at Cairo Festival City and get your free copy. Enjoy 1,000 new ideas and more than 2,000 new lower prices. IKEA 2018 catalog. Make room for life. IKEA.
I don't feel good about this.
There's a number on the wall for all of us, Angel.
Neil Simon's Murder by Death. Meanwhile, a short, sinister man who looks exactly like Truman Capote is preparing a diabolical weekend for the greatest detectives in the world, Sidney Wang.
Don't I think, Pop? Perfect place for a murder.
Conversation like a television set on honeymoon. Unnecessary.
Dick and Dora Charleston.
Dear, would you walk now in the other way? My leg tends to look like a tree in this fog.
Sam Diamond.
I think we picked ourselves a queer bird, Angel. Anything else?
He has no pinkies.
No pinkies? Jimmy Twain has only got 8 fingers?
No, no, he's got 10. He just doesn't have any pinkies.
As we join them, our 5 clue persons and their faithful companions are trapped in a mysterious old mansion where a fiendishly ingenious crime is about to take place.
The victim is here at this very table at this very moment. And so too, ladies and gentlemen, is the murderer.
His most stupid theory I ever heard.
One of us is a mad killer, not to be trusted.
I hope he knows how to stop that thing.
Returning to the kitchen...
Who are you?
The blind butler encounters the dumb cook.
Oh, you must be the new kitchen maid.
Then what has happened to the butler? The cook? Where's the cook?
2 minutes to midnight.
Gunshots, monsieur. Gunshots, Bob.
Gunshots, Sam.
Gunshots, Dickie.
I don't like it. I don't like it one bit.
I like it, but do not understand it.
That can only mean one thing. And I don't know what it is.
It means, are these 5 monumental minds any match for Murder by Death? Eileen Brennan, Truman Capote, James Coco.
What happened?
Peter Falk, Alec Guinness, Elsa Lanchester.
The murderer is...
David Niven, Peter Sellers, Maggie Smith, Nancy Walker, Estelle Winwood, and Myron? Who is the one who done it in the number one who done it? Neil Simon's new comedy, Murder by Death.
Should make an exciting weekend.
Welcome back. And before we go into discussing Murder by Death, Vicky, why don't you give us a brief synopsis of the film?
Okay, this movie is about 5 diverse, infamous private eyes, including Sam Diamond, played by Peter Falk, Sidney Wang, played by Peter Sellers, Jessica Marbles, Elsa Lanchester, who are invited to a mysterious Lionel Twain's castle for a dinner party. There, they are told that Twain plans an unsolvable murder in the house at midnight, and he will pay $1 million to the one who determines the killer. But when Twain's blind butler, I can't say this, Benson Mum, right?
James said Benson Mum.
Benson Mum was played by Alec Guinness, and it was brilliant. He was absolutely hysterical. Dies along before the deadline, and the stakes go up for the trap sleuths.
So, John, what was your thoughts on Murder by Death?
You know, it's really funny. Like, that movie, I remember seeing pieces of it, not realizing that I had seen it at one point. So when I was watching it last week again and rewatching it, it reminds me so much of, like, just like a Mel Brooks, because there's so many one-liners throughout the movie that you probably can watch this movie like 10 times and still miss some of them because they're so quick and so funny. Like, I'll just, like, one was, you know, with the character of Jessica Marbles, who, when you first see Jessica, you think that Jessica is, it's like they kind of mix the characters up. You think the nurse is the one that's the astute detective, and that Jessica is the actual nurse, but it's the other way around. And so it's like really funny when you see that it's actually, they mix, it's like, no, it's like she's the nurse, she's taking care of the nurse. So there's that. But right. Then at one point Jessica goes, I smell gas. And then the nurse goes, I can't help it, I'm old. And then Jessica says, no, that not that kind of gas, the kind that kills. And then the nurse goes, well, sometimes my gas, and then it kind of like gets cut off. It's so funny. These lines that just come one after another, make it such a, it's a fun movie to watch. And I feel like if you watch it, you want to just rewatch it right away again, because you're kind of like, let me catch some of these lines that I might have missed, because you're laughing so much and laughing so hard that you kind of miss things happening so quickly.
Right.
I mean, there's some classic lines. I mean, Eileen Brennan is at the top of her game in this film.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, which will come.
She was such, I felt so bad for her, because he was treating her like such a dumb blonde. Like, you know, he made me run out of gas because I saw a gas station 5 miles back. He goes, good, I'll wait for a year. You know?
I know.
He was such an asshole. He was such a jerk to the whole movie. Talk about a sexist pig, you know? He was terrible. He was brilliant acting, but it was funny. I mean, it was so over the top.
Well, some of Peter Sellers' lines is like, conversation like television set on honeymoon, unnecessary.
or be careful on the road, it's treacherous. Treacherous is road like fresh mushroom, must always, and the sun drives away. Idiot, you not let me finish mushroom story, idiot.
Oh my God, that was Truman Capote was getting mad at him because he wasn't doing his most preposition, but
yeah,
he kept missing all the. He wasn't,
how do you not miss? How do you not understand the pronouns? Them.
Well, I have to say, it's one of these films that is kind of comedy gold, because every actor is basically on point and they're so perfect. I mean, you know, you got David Niven and Maggie Smith going off each other. And then you got David Niven saying, up there, Nora, look, a blind butler. And then Maggie Smith goes, oh, don't let him park the dock car, Dickie.
And then it's so funny because then he's like, oh, take your bags up. And then after I'm done parking your car, and she just looks at her husband like, oh, God.
Well, it was funny because whoever was trying to kill everybody kept putting their shoe size, the direct shoe size at the door of their feet. So when the gargoyle fell off the building each time one of them came to the door. Yeah. You know, would fall off, they just miss it. That's Alec Guinness opening the door, and you know, and thinking he's closing it, and he was blind. So he was just, Alec Guinness was just remarkable in his performance in this. Totally love him.
I mean, it's pure comedy genius to have a blind butler and a deaf dumb maid.
She had a note for everything. She just like, here, I'm gonna pull a note.
I don't work on Thursdays.
But I mean, I have to say that they after making this film, the film was a complete success, and there has been talks of moving to the stage at one point, and I think someone wanted to turn it into a musical at one point, which didn't happen. But and then they wanted to do a sequel, but because most of the cast were starting to die off because they were at that age, they did make a sequel called The Chief Detective, which does have the Peter Falk character, Sam Spade, Eileen Brennan, and Eileen Brennan's best friend, which is Madeline Kahn, in the film as well, with James Coco and James Cromwell as Perrault and his chauffeur do come back for The Chief Detective, but they weren't able to get the whole cast together again for a proper sequel.
But they had absolute chemistry, all the actors did in this movie.
I have to say, though, James Cromwell, I mean, God, he looks so young in this film.
Yeah, I mean, same with Maggie Smith. I mean, come on, she looked yeah. stunning. I was like, wow.
Yeah, you just all every time you think of her, you think of, you know, Harry Potter, you know.
Or I mean, again, like Gosford Park or Downton Abbey, like, you know, it's yeah.
Or Sister
well,
Act.
She sort of got landlocked.
Or Sister Act, yeah, exactly.
Well, she got landlocked into that role of Harry Potter because now you know, when you see something that Maggie Smith had done pre-Harry Potter, it's like, oh, wow, this was a very diverse woman and actor. And she wasn't just, you know, the teacher, you know, at Harry Potter. So,
I mean, the thing about Murder by Death, which is quite interesting, is every actor in this film, by this point in their career, have either won a Tony, a BAFTA, an Academy Award, or some kind of huge award for, and most of them, I mean, all these actors in this film are actually stage actors who,
right.
you know, they did a lot of, you know, they did films, but the stage acting was their big forte, which I think it does show. I mean, the thing is they, even to the smallest part, they all, I think what you get with stage acting a lot of times that you don't get with movie actors is that they know what to do with little bit of business or little every little line. They just know how to put the right infliction on it or stuff like this. So they really know how to round out a part. Even if something happens, they got no lines at all. They still got a little bit of business going on in the background. If you watch them in the background, they're still doing something.
Yeah.
Whether it's Maggie Smith, like holding her pearls or just giving that kind of look. And Elsa Lanchester, I mean, I'm not familiar with her work. The only thing I really know from her is Bride of Frankenstein. But she's...
Oh, yeah. She was forgot about that.
And the Estelle Winwood. I mean, she doesn't say much, but when she does say stuff, she's brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, and then I'm just going to look like they're all holding hands so they can figure out, because no one wants to die at this table. And Peter Falk's going, stop it. Stop it. And they go, what's wrong? The old bird's giving me the finger.
He's just giving me the finger in the palm of my hand. Just
saw him. but yeah, I mean, Murder by Death, I came across Murder by Death in HBO in its infancy. HBO would just come on and everyone's getting HBO, and it's one of those movies that they showed and they would play over and over, and every time it was on I just fell in love with it. And it's one of those films that my friend Gary, who I've been friends with for 40 some odd years now, we'll just look at each other and we'll just quote lines. It'll be like if we're at a party or out to dinner and someone says something witty, Gary or I will look at it and go, oh, I like her. I really like her.
Yeah.
And we just start quoting lines from this kind of films because it's one of those films that you can just quote various lines from all the time. So, I mean, it's a true classic, and it's a shame that they don't really make these anymore.
Yeah, I agree.
I was thinking that too. They're just movie gold because, you know, I don't even really go to the movies that much anymore because, I mean, they just don't make stuff like this anymore. It's just not as entertaining. And, I mean, you can watch it several times, and each time you watch it, you see something that you miss. It's just one of those movies that has all that little innuendo and everything else in it.
There was actually an additional deleted scene that they just removed, and it was supposed to be showing Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson arriving at the inn when the guests are leaving, and they're the ones who actually solved the crime, basically, at the end. And it says then their roles were reduced to cameo appearances and finally deleted as the lead actors felt they were being upstaged. That's funny. You know, it's like the two characters that come at the end.
I probably think another reason why they probably felt like they would be upstage a little bit. I also think that because when they were making this film, all these actors are friends with each other and they all have long histories with each other. And if you find that if you go back into their film and play histories, you realize that they've all worked together at one point or another in their careers. And they're all quite close.
Yeah.
Apparently when they were filming this, they all quite lived together. They all kind of lived in the same commune, and they had that. So I imagine bringing two characters in at the end, which wouldn't have that continuity for them.
Yeah,
must have felt be quite weird. And I also think it's like if you're the actor playing Sherlock Holmes and the Watson, you're probably thinking like it's 15 best friends and one left out sort of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Like who are these people, the outcasts? I know Christopher Guest does that with his cast. He does like Best in Show, Waiting for Guffman. It's like all the casts are like so close together that so no matter what he does, he would, you know, bring them back in again, and they the one thing I love about this movie too is the characters are so different and distinctive that it's like, you know, when Milo and Marcel, it's like at one point I was like, oh, they're very different from the others, because Milo is very pompous, and then Marcel is like, I couldn't determine if he was just very flamboyant or if he was gay or not, but it was just like cute to see the chemistry between the two of them. It's like, you know, like servant, you know, you're going to do what I'm going to do. And he would always fight back and be a little like sassy to him. And then, you know, you have Dick and Dora who are like, again, a sassy couple, but like pompous and very astute in their characters. And, you know, and then you have Sydney and the son, and like how the poor son, who is like the adopted son, was just adopted because he basically needed someone to take care of him and serve him. So
carry his bags everywhere. He's called number three's adopted son or something.
Because the butler was going to take the bags up. Ben was going to take the bags up, and he's like, no, my son will do it. And it's like, God.
He's adopted.
Yeah, my adopted son will do it.
I was like, Willie, you need to cover the body. Why me, Dad? That's what we adopted, because your mom's not here.
And he's like, oh, what do you say? He's like, well, wait, if we go to sleep and we think on this, what if we're killed? He's like, then you did it.
I mean, one of my favorite scenes is when you got Eileen Brennan and Peter Falk in the car together. And she's going through the whole history about Twain and all this stuff. And he goes, and Peter Falk goes, oh, you did a fantastic job. Where did you get all your information? He goes, oh, I wrote Twain himself, and this is what he gave me.
I don't remember. Do you remember the original character, Sam Spade, that they're kind of spoofing on here? He was like a real, you know, gumshoe kind of sexist person, wasn't he, in the movies?
Well, yeah, in the 30s, they did the Maltese Falcon, which is, you know, Humphrey Bogart,
yeah.
And I love that movie.
And basically, Sam Spade is Humphrey Bogart in Maltese Falcon. I think that I can't remember what his character name was. And Sam Diamond is his name here. Sam Spade's Humphrey Bogart character. But, I mean, Peter Falk would actually take this character and move it one step further with television and with the Columbo. Basically, it's the Columbo episode. Basically, Humphrey Bogart, isn't it?
Basically. Yeah. Yeah. I forgot about Columbo. I used to watch that when I was babysitting, and I was like 16. Because, you know, we only had like 13 channels in Watertown. You know, state New York, we had 13 channels. So that was what was on.
But that's what they're saying. I mean, there's not one weak link in this film. And that's probably why I also love this film. It's just kind of, I mean, I watched it last night again. And I just laugh all the way through it. From the beginning it starts, the way it ends, and I had to sit there and say, I think a lot of that has to do with Neil Simon, because Neil Simon, I mean, if you look at Neil Simon's body of work, whether it's Barefoot in the Park, Biloxi Blues, The Goodbye Girl, The Odd Couple, and Neil Simon is one of the few authors has the most plays ever produced, has won the most Academy Awards, and won the most Tony Awards than any other author in history. And I think it does show. Whenever he writes for a character, he really knows how to write for that character, and he knows how to deal with just little nuances and stuff like this.
Yeah.
And I have to there say that, unlike Christopher Guest, which a lot of that's ad-lib, which is comic gold, I think with Neil Simon, I think everyone just sticks to the wording, and they really have to stick to that. And I mean, even when you see Maggie Smith in California Suite and the other Neil Simon plays that some of these other actors have done, you can tell that they really stick to the script. There's no ad-libbing, and it's all quite well contained. And I think that's probably why that they used a lot of theater actors for this. And Neil Simon used a lot of theater actors in most of the plays. It's very rare that he would use outside of theater. You know, Marcia Mason was one of his favorites.
Right.
And I think that's because Neil Simon wanted everyone to say his words. And I think that if you have a fantastic writer, I think it shows. I think if something happens, you don't have such a fantastic writer or whatever, then you can have actors do a bit of ad-libbing or changing their lines. But I think with Neil Simon, I think he pretty much have to say what is written.
And it helps. I mean, to me, I think it would also help the actor or actress to be able to harness what the character, the nuances of the character, because you trust the words that are given to you, but then that allows you to elaborate or, you know, build off of what the character is and exude that character. And it's done so well because there's not one character in that is forgettable, right? So, yeah. And you know, when you watch a movie nowadays, when it has such a huge cast of characters, you always kind of go, well, who was that person in the back? And remember that guy that was like this movie, you remember every single character, which is really hard to do nowadays. And that is, it relies on the good writing, you know, that's what it relies on.
Well, they had to, all the actors though, they just had so much chemistry, you know, and you had Peter Sellers, David Niven. I mean, they were hysterical, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, Peter Sellers, I mean, you just can't go wrong with Peter Sellers. He just captivates just about every role he had. When he's like, basically, he was a Charlie Chan spinoff, you know. And I remember watching the Charlie Chan movies, the old black and white. See, he did have what he called it, Number One Son, I believe.
Yeah, his Number One Son.
Yeah. Number One Son.
It actually reminded me, that character reminded me of Dr. Lau. For whatever reason, I kept going, oh, it's Dr. Lau. He's hanging out.
I did too. I thought the same thing. Oh,
well, I guess we should attack the issue. There is a bit of racism going on in this film.
Oh yeah.
But I think the funny thing is you only get it through one character. And I think that,
right.
And I think because of that one character, because of the way he is, he's supposed to be like, you know, a streetwise cop from the 30s, 40s, you know, on the street. And he's pretty much like one of these poor detectives who solves crimes but never gets the money that everyone else gets. And he's a man from the slums sort of thing. And I think it shows up quite funny, but it's quite funny because the way he attacks the issue, and the thing is like, and people just go, oh, that's just the way he is, and they carry on. So it's quite funny the way that everyone reacts to it in the film.
Yeah, there's a line where it's like, it is late, my eyes are getting tired. So Sidney Wong says this, and then Sam goes, I thought you always looked like that. And then Jessica goes, knock it off, Sam. And Sam goes, I apologize, this case is getting to me. I'm sorry, Slanty. Thank you.
Well, what about the actors like James Coco and James Cromwell, you know, where he comes in with that heavily French accented, I don't remember how to say his name, Milo Pierre. He was always worried about dinner. He was worried about dinner the whole time.
Yeah, he was always eating.
Alec, he just comes in, he thinks he's serving soup, you know, the blind butler, and there's no soup going in his bowl.
My bun. Well, you have a bun? You didn't tell me you have a bun.
But then they end up having to sleep in the same bed, and he's like the chauffeur, and you didn't want James Cromwell in there. He plays Marcel Cassé. But they were funny. He goes, where else do you expect me to sleep? He goes, it's just hysterical.
Well, talking about that scene, I think we need to have a small discussion about James Cromwell's bed clothing.
Yeah. Right. Oh my god.
His fishnet robe.
The sheer. I was looking at that twice and I was like, oh my god, that's like a see-through romper.
Yeah.
It was a romper, you know. That was back when, before men wore rompers, you know.
And I never thought that James Cromwell has probably quite a good body on himself at that point in his career.
He had
some gams on him, as I would say.
You can see his ass right through it. I was like, and I think I don't know. I mean, obviously he wasn't wearing underwear underneath his ass.
Mystery solved.
But after they say they did, when he turned around, they filmed it very, very cleverly.
When he went to the door, you know, when he jumped out of bed. I mean, it's like they're both at this crazy French accent.
And I also like how the main detectives, and not their counterparts with them, you know, not their sidekicks, but the main detectives thought they're also very pompous. And I like it when they all try to like outdo each other. And when they're one-upping it, they're just making it up as they go along, just to one-up the other person.
Yeah.
So the room kept switching and they kept going to the room and there was nobody in the room. And then they had to go out of the room and then somebody else come back in. And then Milo comes back in and he's wearing the dead butler's clothes. He goes, don't ask. It was like, oh my God,
Well, the gay issue with Sam Spade's character was very well done and funny as well. And you know, it's like you get Eileen Brennan, was I right, Sam, to tell them about, you know, the gay bars? And he goes, Oh, yes, you were, sweetheart. She goes, why do you keep all those muscle men magazines? I'm always looking for suspects.
So good.
Peter Falk was really, he did that role great. He was hysterical.
Yeah. I also like, I mean, the end was just so absurd and over the top. No, it's not so-and-so. It's, I mean, it literally was like, oh my God, this is so crazy.
I mean, I think it's another thing that the music in this film is very above par, and that's done by David Grushin, the famous jazz musician.
Nice.
Who became really big 10 years later in the 80s. It was a huge name in the 80s. But yeah, I think, I mean, the film works on all cylinders, and I think it's one of those films, I mean, I've said before, I've seen this film so many times, it gets to the point where I can almost recite the lines. And when I'm watching it, I can actually recite most of the lines because I've seen it so many times.
Yeah.
But I mean, the release date was in 1976, and it's it's still very, very strong today, and it still works on all kind of cylinders. So,
well, how they wrote it and how the play, the actors was total fluid and continuity. It was just like one thing after another. It was like bam, 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 bam. You know, it was one line after one line. I mean, it was so well done. There's just no way you couldn't want to watch it. You know, because you always see something new. Every time you watch it, there's always something you missed.
So before we go on to our next film, which will be Clue, why don't you give us your final thoughts, Vicky, what you thought of Murder by Death?
Well, I just said it was brilliantly written. The actors had total chemistry. I mean, there was just no way. It was just, like I said, bam, bam, bam. It's like every scene, every line, you know, it was just one after another, and they just did so well together. And if it was 76, you did say 76, it was released. And I mean, like you said, I believe it's still strong today. I think anybody that would watch it would find it totally delightful. Alec Guinness, just watch it for Alec Guinness, because I couldn't stop watching Alec Guinness. And he just sits so good as a deaf butler. I mean, it's excellent. It's funny. It's totally a highly vibrational movie.
If you like Alec Guinness, I suggest you watch Kind Hearts and Coronets. It's one of his first films, and he plays 8 different characters in it. So, where he even plays a woman in it, which is quite interesting. So, John, what's your thoughts? What's your final thoughts on Murder by Death?
Like I said, I had seen it in its entirety, and now I'm going to watch it probably sometime again this weekend, because again, it's that good. It's that funny.
Right. I'm going to watch it again, too.
I wish, this is one of the rare movies that I wish that they would have kept filming outtakes, because I'm sure there was a lot of outtakes. To have this many people who are comedic and to be able to play off of each other, I'm sure, like, you know, Keith said, they stuck to their lines and they really tried to respect the writers in this, but I definitely feel like there was a lot of moments where they just went off the cuff and just went
there's outtakes somewhere out there. They're probably funny as hell, man.
So if anyone hears us and who has these outtakes, please share them at some point, or please get a release to share them, because I'm sure that would just only add to this amazing movie.
Exactly.
And my final thoughts on Murder by Death is one of my favorite movies. I watch it numerous and numerous of times. I mean, it sits next to my Blu-ray player nonstop, and I do bring it about probably 3 or 4 times a year. And it gets to the point where my flatmates get a bit sick of it, but I still agree with it. And I said before, it makes me, I mean, every time I watch it, I just laugh, and I laugh all the way through it. I just, yeah, it's pure.
It makes you happy. It really does. If you want uplifting, you know, it just makes you happy to watch it. It just does.
Yeah. And it works. Parts of it are so stupid that it's funny, and some of it is so intelligent that it's funny. So it works on so many levels. So that's our final thoughts on Murder by Death. So now our next film is the classic 1985 film Clue, which is an ensemble movie that was released, of course, in 1985. So, John, give us a little information about Clue.
Sure. Now that we've solved one mystery, let's move on over to talk about the movie Clue. But before we do, most people don't know this, but Clue, which was Cluedo, actually was a game that was manufactured in the UK back in 1949. Since then, it has been relaunched, remastered several times, and is currently owned by Hasbro. one of my favorite, most recent variations of the game is Clue Golden Girls, which is a mystery of who ate the last piece of the cheesecake. I'm sure it was to die for. Ha,
where do you find this stuff?
but I digress. It wasn't until 1985 where director, writer, producer, actor Jonathan Lynn produced Clue to life, or would it be to death, to the big screen. With the help of actors such as Eileen Brennan, Tim Curry, Madeline Kahn, Christopher Lloyd, Michael McKean, Martin Mull, and Leslie Ann Warren, this ensemble cast put the K in killer and the C in comedy. Though it only grossed $14.5 million, less than the budgeted $15 million, it nevertheless became a cult classic with a massive fan base. Before we get into talking about the film, we will be taking a short commercial break, followed by the trailer of the film. We'll be right back.
See you in a few.
Amazon is here to make your life easier. By just the tap of a button, you can turn the camera on your phone to your own personal shopping list. Introducing Flow. Just tap the camera icon under the search bar, and you can find whatever it is you're looking for right on Amazon. Faster than scanning a barcode and typing the name of your item into the search engine. Besides, searching with words is so 2012. Save time and money. Amazon, where shopping meets effortless.
Every person in this room has the perfect motive.
Stand back!
For murder.
What do you mean? Murder.
But only one of these suspects is the murderer. Is it the timid Mr. Green?
Why are you screaming?
Because I'm frightened!
Of what?
Screaming!
Or the militant Colonel Mustard?
If I was the killer, I would kill you next. Huh? Said if.
Mrs. White, who helped her husband on his way.
Well, it's a matter of life after death. Now that he's dead, I have a life.
Miss Scarlet, who's helped many men along the way.
Practice makes perfect. Huh.
Professor Plum, who's looking for a way.
I'm looking.
Mrs. Peacock.
I have absolutely no idea what we're doing here, but I am determined to enjoy myself.
Or did the butler do it?
No.
Paramount Pictures invites you to an evening of mystery.
Let us in! Let us out!
Murder.
This is getting quite serious.
And madness. In the movie that makes a scene of the crime.
So who did it?
Clue. It's not just a game anymore.
Welcome back. Now we're going to discuss Clue, the 1985 American comedy classic. And to get us started, Vicky is going to give us a brief synopsis of the film Clue.
Okay, Clue. Excellent movie. That's all I got to say. It's based on the popular board game, and its comedy begins at a dinner party hosted by Mr. Body, who's leaving, where he admits to be blackmailing his visitors. These guests who have been given aliases are Mrs. Peacock, who's played by Eileen Brennan, Miss Scarlet, Leslie Ann Warren, who did a brilliant job. Mr. Green is Michael McCain, Professor Plum, Christopher Lloyd, Mrs. White is Madeline Kahn, and Colonel Mustard, Martin Mull. When Mr. Body turns up murdered, all suspects are together and they try to figure out who is the killer. And Tim Curry is absolutely brilliant in this movie as the butler.
And to get it off the discussion, looks like I'll be starting the discussion on Clue. Clue is one of those films I saw at the movie theaters when it first came out, and I saw ending A when it came out, the Leslie-Ann Warren ending. And I think the film would have done better if it didn't have the three different endings, that depending on what showing you went to see, what ending you got.
Right.
Because I think that if you saw the B ending that they did, I think that was probably the weakest.
Yeah.
And I think the strongest one was probably the Leslie-Ann Warren, and the
yes.
C ending was kind of a cop-out ending, I thought. The
right.
Whereas like
which one?
The C ending, which is they all did it. You know, they all.
Well, I mean, that was actually more believable that all of them had, because if you're watching it, like I caught a moment where now, like, you know, when you with Miss Peacock, when she kills the cook, like I was watching it, I was like, oh, she isn't in the room. So if you rewatch the movie, you actually can see who is not where they should be within the scenes, you know?
That's correct. I noticed that as well.
So it's kind of hard with that many dead people to say one person did it. There's no way. There's just,
someone dies, just put them in the other room. Or they put them in the
parlor. Like my favorite is when they're just walking around the rooms, like each one, they're like, oh, no, there's a body in here. Oh, here's another one. Oh, yeah, let's just go here.
Well, Tim Curry, though, just the energy, you know? No matter what ending you saw, it's just the back and forth. And they went to this thing, and they went to that, you know? And he was running back and forth, and this one did this, and this one did this. Picked up the candlestick, you know?
Well, then he did the impressions of each one of them, though, too, which was hysterical, you know, when Miss Peacock, you know, gets upset and she,
so good. She thought the booze was poison.
Yeah, yeah. And did anyone notice the similarities between Death My Murder and in her character specifically, and when she goes to faint and she's like, oh, catch me, and she falls right in front of the blind butler, and then in this one she's the same thing. She's like, I think I'm gonna faint, and literally slides out between the arms of the other person. And I was like, I don't know if that was intentional, but that was really funny.
Professor Plum, Christopher Lloyd. Oh my God, what a nut job that guy is in any performance. You know, he's just one of those actors. I mean, he slides into anything. One, he's already weird looking, you know, he just absorbs his character and just goes with it.
But in this, he plays like a total perv, so.
I know, what was he, a gynecologist or something?
No, he's a psychologist, and he basically was, you know, had a young, you know, patient that he would lay on his couch, you know.
Okay, I thought for some reason he was, I don't know, I thought he was like a female. I thought they mentioned something.
I mean, the cast of this is quite ingenious in a way. I mean, you got Tim Curry, who basically up until this point had difficulty finding work due to him always being typecast as Frankenfurter. So this is actually one of the only roles that he was able to actually show a bit more acting chops. I mean, he did a minor role before that, Times Square, which is a cult film, but it's very rarely seen. But this gave Tim Curry a chance to break out of the Frankenfurter shell. And then you have Michael McKean, who was typecast as a TV actor. I mean, people would probably know him from Laverne and Shirley. He was
Lenny. Yeah.
And this pretty much started his career as doing supporting characters, which he, as from this point forward, you started seeing a lot more of him. Leslie Ann Warren was just getting off of an Oscar nomination for Victor Victoria. Eileen Brennan was Oscar nominated for Private Benjamin. Madeline Kahn, of course, Blazing Saddles. And then you got Christopher Lloyd, who's just coming off of Back to the Future.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting film with the casting side of things, that these people were basically, you know, making their footings in the 80s now. They weren't, you know, settling on, you know, because most of these character actors were basically really big, you know, had names for themselves in the 70s. And this is probably the first 80s film that they were actually brought forward into. So it was you get to see them vitalize in their careers. And another interesting thing is this is produced by Deborah Hill, who also did The Thing, and she did Halloween and all these other films. And she was, for a female producer, she was at the top of her game at this point, as producing, and one of the only female producers at that time.
Yeah.
Well, you mentioned Leslie Ann Warren and Victor Victoria. That movie had to be one of the all-time favorites of mine. I watch it and watch it and watch it. I take it off the shelf every once in a while and watch it. Because it is so funny. I mean, she was hysterical in it. Yeah. It's definitely something that people should watch if you get a chance to watch Victoria.
What I also liked about Leslie Ann Warren's part is that she did play the ingenue in the beginning of her career, but then she kind of went into this vamp kind of character. And then Victor Victoria, you got the vampy one with the annoying voice. And here when she was like, the evil vamp, which I quite like. You know, she's still playing a vamp, but you get, you know, she's showing a different side of her vampness. And there is something very, very sexy. I mean, she had a really good body. She really knew how to.
She did.
She knows how to wear that painted dress of hers.
Yes, she did. She looked fabulous. I mean, just what all of them were wearing was great. Everybody had some kind of individual style of dress they had in this movie. Mm-hmm.
I love Colleen Camp, who was, you know, Yvette's the maid, you know, she was
the little feet of me, the little feet, you know. I mean,
like, how much
do you scream? Because I hurt you.
Look at they get her boobs wore out of her costume, you know?
I mean, Colleen Camp, she's one of these actresses that doesn't really get the notoriety that she deserves. Everything that she does. I mean, she's in the Die Hard films. She's the she always appears in like these little small bit parts. And when you do see her, she's one of those people like, who is that? And no one hardly ever knows who she is. But every part that she does, she's just fantastic in.
Yeah.
And, I mean, what I like about this film, at least she has a bigger part in this, and she really stamps her mark on this part, which I quite like a lot. And but I mean the film is different from Murder by Death, isn't it? But that this is more physical comedy. This is all about physical comedy.
Exactly.
And that's what I quite like about Clue.
The
whole physical thing, and every character again seems to have their lines and their part down straight. They exactly know what they're doing and they're very, very comfortable. I also think it's quite good to see Eileen Brennan and Madeline Kahn work together because they were very, very close friends. They used to work a lot together and other stuff. And I think that Madeline Kahn, God bless her soul. I mean, she...
Yes.
Yeah.
Anything that you ever gave her, doesn't matter if it's the smallest part or even in Young Frankenstein, she doesn't have a big part in Young Frankenstein, but you remember her. You always remember Madeline Kahn in whatever she did.
They had her dressed up all in black and dark and goth looking in this movie. Be like the Black Widow because she looked, they made it look like she killed her husband. So what did your husband do for a living? Well, he just lies around on his back because he's dead, you know?
I mean, I love her because like to this day, anytime I'm around friends and there's that line where she's like, yes, I hated Yvette. I hated her so much. It's like, flames. And it's like, so she, for me, like she's gone, but it's like, good Lord, man. She had some of the best lines, even in Young Frankenstein, which you like, oh, sweet mystery. Yes.
Oh my God. That was great. Yeah. She could do anything. I mean, there's not a better actress that was out there than her.
My favorite scene of Madeline Kahn is, I remember that she hosted Saturday Night Live back when it first began, you know, with the old cast, Jane Curtin.
But it was Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
And Bill Murray. And I remember that she did her Bride of Frankenstein, and she's all dressed up as the Bride of Frankenstein, and she sings I Feel Pretty.
Yeah.
Yes.
And if you can find that clip on YouTube, it's very hard to find, but if you see it, she's just hysterical because she just sings the song I Feel Pretty. And then all the villagers come in with their pitchforks and they're going, what? She goes, look at the pretty girl in that mirror. And they go, what mirror? Where? It's just And then another great clip if you want to see the genius is that Madeline Kahn sings with Grover from Sesame Street. And it's fantastic. Because she used to appear on Sesame Street every once in a while as well, doing little bits of the Muppets. And she did the Muppet Show as well. And everything she did was just pure gold. She's just one of these people that everything that she did was fantastic. Even from like her first movie, which was Barbara Streisand and Ryan O'Neal in What's Up, Doc?
Yeah,
that was great. Yeah.
You know, and that
same
was
thing same thing with Eileen Brennan. I mean, I remember her with like Sergeant Benjamin. I mean, it just, she's such a great actress. And it's kind of cool to know they were like friends, but again, it's like to be in the room with that in that environment. Oh my God.
Goldie Hopper, best of friends. She sounds like she said Private Benjamin.
Well, Eileen Brennan, during Private Benjamin, she became really good friends with Goldie Hawn and they were out to dinner. And then Eileen Brennan got hit by a car.
And
she had to stop acting for like 3 years. And, but you know, she took everything in her stride. And after that, she got cancer after Madeline Kahn died of cancer from the same kind of cancer. I mean, she got over that.
Yeah.
But you know, if you read anything about Eileen Brennan, it's like everyone talks about pure class, fun to, you know, no one ever says a bad word about her. Apparently, she's just so professional, but she's tough as cookies, but soft as caramel inside, they would say about her.
Yeah.
And I had to, my hat's off to Eileen Brennan because her last movie was Jeepers Creepers. And
she could absorb in any role as well.
Yeah.
I mean, they just don't have actors like that. I don't care. I'm trying to offend anybody in the new age. But I mean, they just, as the old adage say, they just don't make them like that anymore.
Or again, it's the ensemble, right? They all, again, one thing commonality between this and Death by Murder is that to be able to bring a cast together like this and that they each played off of each other so well, and they were all memorable characters, you know. Aside from some of the people who were killed, maybe. Yeah, maybe.
But even when they died, it was funny. Was when they shot, when she shot Tim Curry. Oh, because that was a good shot. He's sitting there dying in the corner.
Yeah, or it's like 2 + 1 + 2 + 1 + 2.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
No, it's 1 + 2 + 2 + 1 + whatever.
I also think that you get from here that I think they were very close, because if you look at this film and you look at what they later did in their careers, I think that some relationships were formed, because Christopher Lloyd and Michael McKean and Martin Mull end up working together with Christopher Guest. Weren't they all did like the Best in Show and the Mighty Wind? And
yeah, they did. And that's what I was saying. That director had that sort of, he had the ability to collect these people, and they all apparently loved working together. Otherwise, you know, Parker Posey, like all these people would not work together movie after movie after movie if you didn't like each other, you know?
But I think that those three relationships probably started with this film, I think, because there's no record of these three people ever being in, I mean, maybe they went to school, who knows what went on behind the scenes, but it seems like this is the first time that these three people worked together, and after that they became quite standard working together in that kind of field. But I have to say, I mean, Clue does work on a lot of different levels, and I have to say there's not a boring moment in it. There's not part where you find yourself, your mind wanders. And some comedies, your mind does wander. You get like a few kind of comedy moments and classic moments. And then and then you get this stagnant thing in the middle. As I said before, I think that the reason why Clue didn't make the money it should have made is I do think that, you know, it's 1985. A lot of big movies came out at that time. And I don't think the three different endings, playing it what time you saw it and what theater you went to see it, probably helped the matters. I think people just thought,
I agree, especially if there's a weak ending that you're like, that's it. No, you know, I'm kind of glad that they did for the, you know, the DVD release, that they did all three, and they did them like, it could have happened this way. Maybe it happened this way, but this is how it happened. Like, I actually thought that was smart, you know?
I liked it. I liked the ending, how it did it, because even in the board game, remember when we were kids, I mean, we played it, it did have three endings.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, and I mean, I love the first one though, with Leslie Ann Warren, you know, when she knew she was caught, she goes, oh God, you're good. You know,
but
figures out she did everything. Tim Curry, that is. And I love the first one though.
And I also think that, I mean, you got John Landis who helped write the script. I mean, John Landis, American Werewolf in London, 48 Hours. And you have that also who helped with the script and stuff like that. I mean, John Landis is, you know, quite the god of 80s cinema at this time as well.
Exactly.
I'm kind of worried though, because they are considering doing a remake.
It was
announced
in
January.
No. And
Ryan Reynolds is supposed to be in it, but it's established a 3-year first look deal with the studio, would star live action remake of Clue. And then, you know, it's like, I'm hoping that they just don't screw this up.
When people say, everybody's, you know what the problem with Hollywood now, and this is going to probably offend people, they don't really have nothing. They got nothing now. And so you've got all these rebirths and reboots and everything else of movies, you know, and you just, these things, you can try to put new characters in and refresh the story, but it's never going to match up or be on that caliber as the original.
Yeah.
Not going to.
And then the writers are going to be Rhett Reese and Paul Wernick, who are the ones who are doing Deadpool with him. So it's going to be funny, but it's sometimes like too much funny. It like breaks away from the simplicity of it. and like Keith was saying, this was more of a physical comedy than a verbal, you know, comedy. And it was just how they played off of each other that way. So if they keep it to that sort of standard, then it might do well, but it's just, you know,
are they going to actually do it?
Yeah, I mean, Fox is right now in negotiation with doing it.
I mean, I think the reason why this movie works is because the actors that they chose for this are not lead actors; they're character actors.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I think that if you're going to make a movie like this work, and same thing with Murder by Death, they're not lead actors; they're all character actors.
Yeah, they might stage be character actors too. Yeah,
they might be character actors.
That's what made it so good.
Well, I mean, with character actors, I mean, there's this one film, and it's a Don Knotts film. It's one of my favorites, called The Ghost of Mr. Chicken.
Yes!
And it's one of the only films that is filled with nothing but character actors. And the movie shines from that. And Murder by Death is character actors. Clue is character actors. And I think that if you got something like this, I think character actors work because you need people who, when you got a multi-level cast like this, I think with character actors, they know how to bring their characters to life. Where if you're a lead actor like Ryan Reynolds, nothing against his acting, but, you know, or Tom Cruise or whoever, whatever lead character you want to put, they're used to everyone being played around them. You know, and the thing is, I'm a lead actor. But character acting is really, really difficult because what you're given is you're giving like small parts and you have to make this whole character realized and fully realized through three or four lines. And that's what character actors do fantastic. And that's why when you get a film like Clue or Murder by Death, is that that's the reason why you can watch it. Everything's fully realized.
Yeah. And they play off of each other, not overshadow each other. And that's the concern is like with most, you know, Hollywood films now, it's like one character tends to float to the surface while other characters float down, you know? And you just, I mean, if you put like him into it, then you're going to put like a Kristen Bell who has like a very bubbly animated like self too, because you almost have to match now that person with other people that are similar to his level of comedy. And then, like I said, then you're going to have to stay at sort of that level of comedy and go with it.
But how do you replace that cast? I mean,
they're irreplaceable.
It's sort of like the Dirty Dancing. So if they did a remake of Dirty Dancing, I got it to 10 minutes. That was it. Couldn't get past 10 minutes of it. I don't think if they remade this, I don't care how great the actors are, you can't replace these actors because they don't make character actors like that anymore.
Yeah.
And they don't put them in movies anymore. You just don't see it.
Yeah.
Well, I also think with character actors, I mean, Madeline Kahn's a character actress and Eileen Brennan's also a character actress. And if you notice when they're acting together in this film, she knew, Madeline Kahn basically knew that her character is completely still at all times. And if you look at Madeline Kahn, the way she portrays her character, Mrs. White is very, very still. She doesn't move she doesn't do anything. And even when she goes off the handle, she does it just very slow
movements.
Where Eileen Brennan
like grabs, she'll like do her pearls, like it's very subtle, you know.
And Eileen Brennan, on the other hand's character, who's a totally different character, and then what she does with her character is she's always moving, so the feathers in her hair is always moving no matter what she's saying. Her head's always shaking like she's got some kind of weird Parkinson's.
Well, like she's a peacock.
Yeah.
Which is smart because they made her kind of like with, you know, little like frilly, you know.
They did. Just that, well, they kind of dressed her like a peacock, kind of. She had that stuff in her hair. You know, accessories. They accessorized her hair, and she was flouncy looking, and they called her Mrs. Peacock. And, you know, just when she was eating the soup, and she goes, this is one of my favorite recipes, you know, giving it away right there that she possibly might be one of the bad guys.
But I also like the...
Right. What is it with soup? With these older movies, everybody's got a soup scene, you know, and a butler. Yeah. I mean, how do you replace Tim Curry? I'm sorry.
Yeah, Tim Curry is, he's amazing.
The energy, when he's saying, you know, it's a physical movie, he gets so much energy in this movie. He's bouncing back and forth, you know.
I'm shouting. Yes, I'm shouting.
I mean, one of the interesting facts about this movie is that Carrie Fisher was originally Scarlett. But because of her drug and alcohol problems, she had to go into rehab, and Lizanne Warren stepped in at the last minute.
Right.
Oh, wow. Talk about a different movie, too.
It would have been totally different from Carrie. Carrie Fisher might have carried it really well, too.
Yeah.
Because she's sort of, do you remember her in, what was it, the Blues Brothers? She was trying to kill John Belushi throughout the whole movie. It was great.
I think the problem, I'm glad that she got help for alcohol, but I think that it actually helped that she was in this movie because I think at this point, unfortunately, I think she was always going to be looked at as Princess Leia.
I think
that creates a problem for her, even though she was very good in small roles, like when Harry Met Sally and things like that, where she really did shine. But I can remember going to see when Harry Met Sally and when she appeared, and everyone goes, oh, look, it's Princess Leia in the cinema.
Oh, God. So, can you imagine? Like, that's what you're known for, you know?
Yeah.
Princess Leia, every teenage boy's dream.
But that's what they're saying. I mean, but then today, I mean, it's quite fortunate for actors today that they don't get the typecasting that they once did get. I mean, if you were known for a role, that was pretty much it. Nowadays, yeah. I don't think that really happens to actors. I don't think that you watch Christian Bale and go, oh, look, it's Veronica Mars, or you know, or
people. Yeah.
And they, you know, you got actors jumping from television to film to stage and back and forth, and
right.
They get painted with the same brush they did it back in the 80s. In the 80s, I mean, if you get in a role and it was iconic, you were that role. Christopher Reeve is always Superman.
Yes.
But I think now only thing that I think actors and actresses suffer is their typecast of character. So if you're a superhero, you become a superhero and another thing, and you're, you know, or you're a detective and now you're a detective, or you're a bad guy and now you're a bad guy. It's like, so that unfortunately tends to happen. So you might not have one character that you're remembered for, but you're, oh, that guy always plays a villain, or oh, that guy always plays the, you know, the hooker. You know, it's like
they do get kind of stigmatized into a role. You know, it's hard to watch. God, okay, they could be able to do it, because I do think that Carrie Fisher, you know, actually did interject well, you know, into other movies and roles. Yeah. But still, like in your head was Princess Leia. You know, like my brothers, you know, they all say remember her as Return of the Jedi when she had her like barely minimal aluminum outfit on or whatever it was. Like I said, she's every teenage boy's dream.
I mean, one of my favorite roles of Carrie Fisher, you know, we're going off way off.
A little bit, I know. We're getting bad here.
One of my favorite characters is when she did Soap Dish, when she played the agent, because she was like, you know, my name is so-and-so. And she goes, my name is da-da-da-da, and I'm a bitch. You know, like, it was so good.
But I think that, I mean, you know, there was a TV series based on this movie, Clue. It was quite short-lived, and it got really bad reviews. And the video is available to download through Amazon, the series. And all I can sit there and say is that the customer feedback on that was, please don't download this series.
Right.
Well, obviously, it wasn't very good, so...
Yeah,
you got people going, please don't download the series. Although, the worst mistake
you made. Please don't ruin your perception.
Don't ruin it for me.
Well, the worst thing about it is that if you had Amazon Prime, you could watch it for free, and people were still telling people not to watch it. So, obviously, there's some.
They're basically asking Amazon, can you give us our membership fees back? Because.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have the. I don't think some movies they try to do the spin-off series. So, Private Benjamin with Eileen Brennan. I mean, that actually did quite well for a while. I mean, at least the first two seasons, or at least the first season. I remember watching it. I thought they nailed it the first season.
Yeah.
But I mean, I remember watching it in the 80s, but I kind of faded away. But some of it was pretty good.
Yeah.
But she was still Eileen Brennan, no matter what.
Yeah.
I mean, still did that role. I mean, she's fantastic.
I would have been so intimidated by her, because she just seemed like she was such a, like, strong presence, and like, you know, to hear Keith say that she was actually, you know, just a softie, you know, that makes me like love her even more. Like, you know, I would feel like if I ever was to run into her, I would have probably went the other direction, being like, I can't say hi to her. She would probably just be like, you know.
I mean, Eileen Brennan, I think another good thing for the end of her career, I mean, she did do a lot of guest appearances on Will and Grace before she passed on. And I think that she was fantastic in that. I think she might have been nominated for an Emmy or something like that for her appearance in Will and Grace. I'm not sure if she won, but I think she was nominated. I mean, one of the interesting facts about Clue is that when they were first thinking about bringing Clue to the screen, Tom Stoppard, the Pulitzer Prize writer, was asked to write it, along with Stephen Sondheim and Anthony Perkins.
Oh, wow. That would have been amazing.
Right. Yeah.
Especially Anthony Perkins, because there is that dark element to Clue that's not really so much in Murder, Death by Murder, because it's one of those where it's like, it's funny, but then there's still moments of being dark and mysterious, you know, and like that. What Anthony Perkins would have been amazing to have them collaborate.
He has a dark and unnatural, you know, facade in just about any role, but he's always still the crazy guy from Psycho. Talk about somebody who's been typecast.
Yeah.
Anthony Perkins, like, how's mom? Yeah, Psycho, you know, mom, somewhere in the cellar, you know.
Well, the thing about Anthony Perkins is that he was a twisted, tortured soul anyway. I mean, if you know anything about his personal life at all, he was very tortured and twisted. He wasn't too far apart from, you know, the characters he played, whether it was Norman Bates in Psycho or his, you know, sexually obsessed priest character in Crimes of Passion or any other characters he played.
Yeah.
So you know, and I have a feeling that if he did write for Clue, it probably would have had some of that twisted, dark, tortured character, because he tend to bring that to everything. That,
yeah. You know, yeah.
You know, even like when his family discuss him, I mean, you know, they, you know, it's always dark and twisted, and everyone has said he's a really nice, lovely, good looking boy, but there was a, you know, a dark side underneath the persona of him. So,
yeah.
So well, he carried that into his acting and, you know, into Psycho.
Yeah.
You know, talk about another brilliant film later on down the pike, probably. That was his.
Yes.
Fantastic as well.
So. But I think that, I mean, I think Clue's overall, I mean, I think it works on very, very many levels. And I do have to sit there and say it was great to see Howard Hessman appear at the end as well. I remember him from WKRP in Cincinnati.
Oh, my God, I know.
Dr. Johnny Fever.
What was it, Johnny? What was it? Oh, gosh, what was his name? And WKRP.
Dr. Johnny Fever.
Yeah, Johnny Fever.
Fever.
Oh, my God. That was, talk about one of the funniest sitcoms ever. I mean, I have to go watch him now just thinking about it, because I just loved that show. It made me laugh so hard. I mean, I wish they had stuff like that out now.
I mean, the only strange thing I found in this movie was using Jane Weedlin as the telegram girl. And I'm kind of like, I wonder if they caught her in
there. Yeah, how did that happen?
Because she had a single out at that time in 85. I think she released her single. I mean, Belinda Carlisle was going quite well with her. Right. Her solo career from the Go-Go's, and I think Jane Weedlin had her Rush Hour song, so I'm not like, oh, she's doing Rush Hour, let's put her in this. She's got a song.
I mean, I think, know, it's one of the best scenes, though. It's hysterical, because you don't expect it to happen.
it was extremely random.
Telegram.
Yeah, that was a random scene. Just like, oh.
I remember sitting in the cinema watching it going, and then she pops up and is like, is that, what's Jane Weedlin doing in this?
She had a cameo.
She's very attractive.
She's
very pretty.
Though.
Yeah, she had that 1950s look anyway, didn't she? She had, you know, she's perfectly coiffed for it.
Yeah.
Right.
So, but I think, like, I mean, I think overall, I mean, Clue is a winner, and it's one of these films I don't, you know, it'd be interesting to see what they will do with the remake, whether they are able to. I don't think it's going to be the same film. I don't know if they're going to go darker. They might go cheap with it and make it about all sexual innuendos and get to the point where it's over the top.
Right.
Or, I mean, I guess it'll all depend on, you know, the script as well. But I got a feeling it's not going to have the kudos that this film has. I mean, we'll wait and see, you know.
Yeah. I'm still so stuck in the late 70s and 80s when it comes to some of these movies. Like I said, they just don't make them like that anymore.
Yeah. I mean, Gosford was pretty close to that. Like, Gosford Park, if you've never seen that, it's really, it's witty. It's a little bit, maybe it's a little bit more dramatic than comedy, but there's these moments where it's, the dialogue is great and it's the same sort of mystery, you know, type of thing. But yeah, I would definitely recommend that if you haven't seen Gosford. That comes a little close to it.
But I think the reason why Gosford Park does work on all cylinders is that you're dealing with a director at that time who's used to a large ensemble cast full of people. And you know, whether you look at Nashville or the host of other films that Robert Altman did, you know, Shortcuts, he knew how to take a cast. And even if they were difficult actors, he knew how to rein everybody in to have these fantastic roles. I mean, Robert Altman did MASH. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and all his films are like, you know, cast 1,000. It's like Ben-Hur of major actors all put in one film. And
right.
I think that's why Gosford Park works, because he knows how to do it. I'm not, you know, we'll have to wait and see what this director does. But if he gets a lot of large personalities in it with a lot of, you know, personality flaws that tend to come with a large cast that can come in, it'd be interesting to see if he can be able to manage everyone. And, you know, it'd also be, I guess this would be a test, because it is Ryan Reynolds' own production company that's putting this into production.
Yeah.
Well, I guess we'll soon find out what his ego's like and find out exactly if he's able to rein it in for other people to shine.
Yeah, exactly.
So. Well, we'll definitely be watching for this one. See what they do with it.
If we don't like it, we will tear it apart.
Yeah, we'll come back for another episode and just rip it.
I'm extremely partial. We probably will tear that apart. Mm-hmm. But just wait and you'll watch.
I do probably think that the remake will probably have something that this film didn't have, and that probably would be a board game taking off exactly from the film. The remake probably will have that.
Yeah.
You know, like, whether it's a computer game or a, you know, or a phone game or something like that, it probably will have that. Where I think Clue, the only marketing they really did for this movie, Clue, is they did a novelization of the movie.
Right.
That was,
yeah.
Not quite. I think it was read by Michael McDowell.
They did a children's book. They said there was also a children's adaptation titled the storybook.
Oh, yeah.
Presents Clue, the storybook.
Yeah, they did that as well.
It's just also really amazing that this spawned out of a game, because that's very irregular, you know, for that to happen. And I think it's that in itself is like interesting to see how it created how many, I think it's like 8 or 9 different variations of the game, including Clue Junior, and then a digital game and a VR game. Like, it's just crazy how much that spawned, but then it spawned this movie, then great, gave it sort of a new success, a new way of showing what the story has, you know.
Well, I mean, Clue or Cluedo in this country, it is still a very popular game. It still sells. My nieces in Spain got it a couple years ago for Christmas, and we played it. I played it in Spanish, which was interesting, considering my Spanish sucks really badly. But I think this movie Clue, I mean, it's quite interesting. If you're into the TV series Psych, their 100th episode was a film, an episode called 100 Clues, where they got together most of the cast, Martin Mull, Christopher Lloyd, and Leslie Ann Warren as suspects in this murder mystery.
Oh, that's so cool.
And they also have multiple endings for their TV episode.
So, oh, cool.
So I think this film is very, very much loved, and it does. I remember, was it last year? John went to Comic-Con, and there was people dressed as the characters from Clue.
We'll have to post that on our site, because I'm one of those geeks that, like, I look across and I'm like, oh my God, that's Clue. And I literally like flew up out of my seat and was like, do you mind if I take a picture? And they look just like them. And I was like, that made me happy, because they're still this fan base that's still there and they're present, you know?
So they also kept that set. Set was bought by the producers of Dynasty. They used it as the hotel, the Carlton.
Oh, how funny.
That's like, I knew that thing looked familiar. Remember Dynasty? Dynasty.
Well, the outside of the house was in Pasadena, and the house burnt down.
Yeah.
Mm. But apparently they had to, was it this film that, yeah, I think it's this film, that they actually had to make the house look larger from the outside, so they actually got green screened it, but matte painted.
Oh, like painted more at the exterior, like created walls, fake walls and stuff, probably.
Yeah, just on the outside, just to make it a bit larger from the outside.
Yeah.
So
I love also the murder by death when it's like fake rain. Like that. <Yeah. laughs> He just likes it ominous all the time. You're like, oh God.
But that's Tutu Twain's house.
Yeah.
Tutu Twain.
So, but I mean, I think Clue overall is, I mean, I think it's worth the watch and stuff like this. So, to give our final thoughts on Clue, Vicky, why don't we start off with you? What are your final thoughts on Clue? What's your final clue on Clue?
My clue. Sometimes I don't have a clue. I think that's why
you guys torture me. You're clueless.
Because you guys like to fuck with me so much. But I have to say, it's probably one of my favorite movies. Like I said, I'm going to be watching for that remake, reboot, whatever you want to call it. Just the characterizations and how they interact with each other. It's just constant fun. It was sort of like Murder by Death. Bam, bam, bam. There's just always something there. Your mind is not wandering, like Keith had specified earlier. Anybody that's younger who has not seen something like that, they really need to watch it. And if you need to smoke a bong or something, do that, because it even makes it funnier when you're high. So, absolutely. I mean, I'll watch it thousands of times. It's up there with Blazing Saddles with me. Totally love it.
And your thoughts, John?
Definitely one of my favorites. It's a rarity that murder mysteries are fun and funny, and I hope that they continue to try to make similar movies like this. You know, the remake, like, hopefully that will be successful, but
I
definitely think that there's some of them try, and I think it kind of goes over the top. So I feel like if you just rein it in and really try to build an ensemble cast that can just play off of the characters and just make it fun and make it a mystery, I just hope that, you know, we get more movies like this, because I love mysteries in general. I grew up with like Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, like, you know, right. Christie, and like a lot of them were serious, you know, there wasn't, it was meant to be more about the mystery. But I think if you can create the comedy and drama and tie it together, I think it just gives such a wonderful air to that industry.
And myself, I really like Clue. I like this. I like screwball comedies that they used to put together, which you don't get too much anymore, outside of like weird romantic comedy sort of things. But I, you know, I love the cast. I, you know, anytime that you can put Madeline Kahn and Eileen Brennan in a movie together,
right,
aces for me. And I think that the film works a lot. I think the women steal. I do find with Clue overall, it's not as even a little bit, because I think the women steal the movie from the men. Yeah. Outside of Tim Curry, but then Tim Curry is always kind of that halfway between man and woman to me. I think that's because of Frankenfurter.
He is rather androgynous.
The androgyny, yeah.
But overall, I think a Clue, I think, will live on. I think, you know, it's still highly available to buy on DVD. You can download it through Amazon and various other avenues. So obviously the film's very, very much in demand because it's still available. So
it's still good. It has aged well.
And before we go, I'm going to throw a curveball at my other guest host and Vicky. Comparing Murder by Death and Clue, which would you prefer, and why?
Gosh, that's a hard one. I probably would prefer Clue because I like the activity more, because I'm so ADHD. I have to have something going on all the time because, you know, it's like a multitasking movie. There's always a scene within a scene. There's something always going on. But it doesn't really take away by Murder by Death. That one is still brilliant. It's just not as fast as the other. But, I mean, they're both great movies. I just like the fastness of Clue and how it just keeps clicking along. But I still like Murder by Death, but Clue is my favorite.
And what about yourself, John?
This is just cruel. This is torture. I cannot believe you just did this to us. No. I mean, I've always been, Clue has been always my love. I do have to say Murder by Death might actually have swayed like the top ranking because of the humor that, again, I love like the whole Mel Brooks type of like humor that it just keeps coming at you and you keep laughing and you almost have to wait. Now you can rewind, right? Before, like, in your, so now it's like you can rewind and rewatch a scene because it just is one thing after another after another. I do agree with Vicky though that Clue has a very fast pace and you kind of get through it, but I'm going to say Murder by Death took number one spot.
And myself, I think it's Murder by Death because I think it's the script writer in me, and I think that the lines hit every single point. In Clue, I find that some of they're the odd lines that do fall a bit flat a little bit. And I do think for me, Murder by Death is like every single cast member's lines hit straight on. And Clue, I figured my only problem with Clue is that sometimes the women outshine the men slightly. Not a lot, just very, very slightly.
Oh, we can't have the women outshining the men in Hollywood industry.
I think it's just a balance. So, like we were saying with Murder by Death, there's a balance that goes across the board, right? You know?
Yeah.
They did give them strong characters and strong script to go with in both movies, though.
But I do think it's from movies. I just think that if you can have an ensemble piece, you got to make sure that every single character is strong. And in Murder by Death, for me, every single character is strong. In Clue, I found that, Michael McKean's character was slightly underwritten a little bit. And it might be because he was quite new to films and stuff like this. And I also found that the women were a lot stronger. I mean, every time the women talked or said something, I laughed. But this could be being a gay guy. Who knows? I tend to like women more than I like guys anyway.
Oh, their discussion on critique.
And I found like sometimes the guys would deliver a line and I wouldn't always laugh sort of thing.
Yeah, it would just kind of fall flat.
Well, the men were hysterical in both. Like I said, Alec Guinness, that was just too much because I always think of him as Obi-Wan Kenobi. And to see him blind butler, it just totally tore me up. I loved it.
It's hard to like take him serious at points when he's just like, get out. And he's like, open
the door. His eyes roll back and he's just like, you know, he's trying to get, You have to watch it, people. Absolutely fabulous stuff.
And I also have to sit there and say, I think what also Murder by Death does is when you have the huge reveal at the end and Alec Guinness is, changes from character to character, when, you know, they accuse him of being somebody else each time. And I just love that. And when he rips his face off. And I also have to say, one thing that Murder by Death has that Clue doesn't have, is I think it's Truman Capote. And the thing is, Truman Capote is one of these people that
you rarely see in anything.
He's kind of a fictionalized character. You know so much about him, but you very rarely see him. And actually experience him, I think, probably actually is the reason why it pushes Murder by Death slightly before Clue. Not a lot, just very, very slightly.
Truman Capote was absolutely fabulous in Murder by Death. I love it. Because it's true, you don't see him much. He's sort of like one of those, he's like a mystery. You know he exists, but you never see him. So.
And I have to sit there and say, the fact that the character had no pinkies and the way they were able to do that was fantastic.
Yeah, I know, right?
Every time I watch it, I mean, I have it in HD. And every time I watch it, I try to look, see where the fake pinkies are. And I can't find it.
The fake pinkies. Now I'm going to have to go back and look.
Because he had no pinkies. So, but anyway, that gives us a close. So, John, do you want to close off our episode of Murder by Death and Clue?
Well, now that me, Keith, and Vicky have done our masterful job of sleuthing these two movies, we still have a very big mystery to solve. How do we get our literary license listeners to head on over to our website at llpodcast.com to find all of our social and podcast platforms, as well as check out past episodes, become a patron, and read our reviews of books to screens and everything in between? Maybe we should bait them. Speaking of bait, make sure to tune in next podcast where we'll be covering the novel and film Jaws. Until next time, make sure to like, share, download our episodes. Adios, bon voyage, sayonara, etc., etc., etc.
See you later.
Bye, guys.
Bye, everybody. Be good.
How do I look so young? Quite simple. A complete vegetable diet, 12 hours sleep a night, and lots of makeup.
Everybody loves the wet. The whole world loves the weirdo. Brains are in a rut, but everybody loves the nut.
There was a hermit named Fred who kept a dead horse in his cave. And everyone said to Fred, Fred, how come you keep a dead horse in your cave? And he said, well,
everybody loves the nut. The whole world loves the weirdo.
Brains are in a rut, but everybody loves the nut. A Columbia man named Frank had a tiger named Hank. He tried to put Hank in his tank. Guess what happened to old Frank? When they picked up the teeth, hair, and eyeballs and erected a tombstone in red.
Everybody loves the nut. The whole world loves the weirdo.
Brains are in a rut, but everybody loves the nut. Another Columbia fella told Queen Isabella, I don't think the world is flat. Now, what do you think about that? And she said, you don't. And he said, no, ma'am. And she said, you get out of my queendom. And he said, yes, ma'am.
Everybody loves the nut. The whole world loves a weirdo.
Brains are in a rut, but everybody loves the nut. Everybody loves the nut.
Oh, that's tacky. That's really tacky.